president, general manager, JJ Piccolo, Matt's family, his wife, Chris, sons, George and Leo. We welcome you to Kansas City and to the Royals. Chairman and CEO, John Sherman here, would like to open with a few words.
Thank you, Sam. I want to pass this off to the two people that I think you've all come to see today, but let me just make a couple comments. Big day for Kansas City, big day for the Royals. Opportunity to meet Matt, maybe for the first time and get to know him. But also JJ, I think he's someone at the table that I think we're starting to learn a lot more about him these days. You know, 6 weeks ago, over the last 6 weeks, I should say, we've talked a lot about organizational change and development, adapting, process improvement. And JJ went right to work in his new role, resulting today in something that the club is very excited about, the naming of Matt Cotraro as our next manager. And JJ, I appreciate your leadership and the sense of urgency that you've taken and kind of going about as you're crafting your vision for our club and for our baseball operations department. Matt, I would say, you know, this is a big day for us, and as you know, JJ put together a very rigorous process as we went about trying to select the best person for this job, and Matt really rose to the top in that process. His career, if you look at his career, his experiences in baseball, from a player to a coach to a bench coach, has prepared him for the challenges ahead here with the Kansas City Royals. Couldn't be more excited. When we announced this deal earlier in the week, I traded texts with Matt really to congratulate him, and he thanked me for the confidence that we're showing in him.
I would turn that around,
Matt, and say thank you for the confidence that you're showing in the Kansas City Royals. When we have these processes, we were interviewing Matt, but he was also interviewing us. And while we selected him, he selected us. And so I very much appreciate, Matt, that you recognize both the opportunity and the potential of this club. So I think Sam wants to take the lectern back from me, and we'll turn this over to the people that we came to see. Thank you.
Matter, my hair was sticking up.
All right. The left is yours as long as you want it, by the way.
Did you want to open up with first, just want to thank everybody for being here today. We're really excited about the announcement of Matt being our manager. But before talking about Matt, I do want to congratulate Chris and Matt's boys, George and Leo. When somebody goes through a process like Matt has several times here in the last couple of weeks, it's stressful for a family. So to eventually land a job that hopefully you're excited about is a family celebration. So welcome to Kansas City. As far as our process was concerned, we're really proud of how we went about this. It was a quick but efficient process, something that we were locked in on from the very get-go. I want to thank John for giving us his support in being aggressive but thorough, and his partners. And I know they're excited about Matt being a part of the organization. I want to thank our baseball operations department. They were tremendous from the beginning, setting up the interview. What are we looking for? What are the qualities we want in this coach? All those things that go into identifying what the Kansas City Royals needed at this point, our baseball operations department stepped up. We had a really good panel, a committee, if you will, of six people, from the design of the interview to the questions that were being asked, to the follow-up, to the debriefing that happened after every interview that we had, ultimately to making the decision of who our manager was going to be. Those six people were very influential, as well as many others. You know, the criteria we started out with, a very large number of names. So trying to get down to what exactly are you looking for. We identified somebody that had experiences that we thought were important, whether it be previous major league managing experience, bench coach experience, minor league managerial experience. That was important to us. We identified a personality and a leadership type that we thought would mesh well with our players. We identified the need for somebody that was willing to collaborate across all departments that we have within this organization. Matt clearly answered that bell. Once we realized that we were not focused or going to land a manager that had previous managerial experience, it became even more important that we had somebody that sat next to successful managers in the major leagues. By sticking to that criteria, I think we were able to go from that large number of candidates down to a pool of about seven. It was seven people that we interviewed. Six we interviewed in person, 6 to 7 hour interviews. One person was involved in the playoffs, so his interview process was a little bit different. But to arrive at this decision in a 2 week period, it was 2 weeks ago today that you came in. To arrive at this decision in 2 weeks, I'm really thankful for all those that were involved. One thing I think is important to note, I was clear with the general managers that we asked permission of their employees. We were interviewing the person and how he fit our organization and not interviewing the organization they were coming from. I think that's important. There's a distinction between the two things. And that's something that we knew would come out, and we learned a lot about other organizations, more about their values than their processes, which we were fine with because we knew the background of our candidates. Ultimately, whoever is in this seat, we're going to be able to talk about our processes moving forward. So I want to be clear about that. As for Matt, I mean, we couldn't be more excited. He's been through this process many times. I mean, he's had a really difficult 3 weeks being involved in many searches. It was really clear how he connected with everybody he came in contact with, his humility, his ability to explain to us what his decision process is or what that looks like. Was very clear. He was very composed throughout the entire process, which makes us feel very good about how somebody's going to react in the dugout. But it was also pretty obvious the people he's been around in his career have shaped his thoughts, his beliefs, and how he will make decisions moving forward. He's been very fortunate to be around very good managers and other coaches along the way, many of which we identified with from years ago. So that was something we didn't really expect. The last thing I'll mention is, when you're coming to a close, you're really trying to figure out how do we poke holes in the guy that we want. I could not find anybody that had anything negative to say about Matt Quatraro. But even after we announced Matt's hiring, the text messages I received, people I knew well, people I don't know well, just really applauding our decision, but more so applauding Matt. So with that, Matt, I want to welcome you as our 18th manager in Royals history. We're looking forward to this partnership.
Well, I'll probably just start by saying it won't take long for people here or somebody else to find something negative to say because people are going to find something at some point, right? This is a tough job and people are going to have negative messages delivered. But I think the one thing that was really clear through this process is that we're going to have a process for the way we make decisions. And I was very confident in that. And that came out every step of the way. And I think that's going to go a long way. The transparency is going to go a long way with the players, with the staff, with the whole organization, with the community. So, but what a tremendous honor, like just to be named the manager of the Royals. It is a culmination of the process, but it's also just the beginning of our partnership together and what we expect to be great things going forward. I feel extremely fortunate to be sitting here today. I'd like to thank Mr. Sherman, ownership, JJ, and the front office for entrusting me to help lead the organization going forward in this next exciting chapter of this really storied franchise. It's extremely humbling, and I know I wouldn't be sitting here without the support of a lot of people.
To beat me.
my family, my mom and dad, and all the, you know, I've had a, like JJ said, I've been really fortunate, not only in the major leagues, but throughout my life to be around really good coaches and people that have mentored me. And like I said, as excited as I am to be named the manager, I'm even more excited to jump into the process. You guys will learn that about me. I'm extremely process-oriented. And I think the process that we all envision here is building a championship environment that is going to bring the Royals back to the top tier of Major League Baseball and be that way year after year. I mentioned the commitment, the support, the forward thinking that I'm confident is here will undoubtedly serve us well putting perennial contenders on the field. And the last thing I'll just close with is beyond the stuff that's the obvious things, the baseball part of it, the focus that was here on the people in the organization, not just in this group, but years prior, it really bursts through when you talk to people. There's a lot of loyalty. A lot of people have great experiences with how the organization has helped their families and the community, and I'm excited to be a part of that. So thank you very much for the opportunity.
Guys, we're going to do questions. I think I've communicated this with most of you. We're on a little bit of a time crunch. We're going to get Matt with you guys in smaller groups as best we can today and into the future. But I appreciate you working with us on that. Just raise your hand. I'll write you down. Joel, you go first.
Welcome to Kansas City. Joel Goldberg with Bally Sports and Royals Television Broadcast. Fans have heard the name. They don't know a lot about you yet. What is your style of baseball like? And from afar, what were your observations of this young Royals team?
Yeah, I mean, rightfully so. I tell my wife I'm easily forgettable. So there's a lot of years of, kind of just, I like JJ said, I'm really fortunate to have observed a lot of really good baseball over the years, minor leagues, major leagues. And I think I've just taken my style, I would say, is what team is put together. I wouldn't shoehorn myself into, I love, Earl Weaver. You know, everybody likes three-run homers and strikeouts for the pitchers. But, whatever style of team that we put together is what we're going to work with. And I think more so than anything, I'm a believer the things I've seen my last couple stops are depth, playing the whole roster, utilizing everyone. So that, that helps performance on the field, but it also helps the environment in the clubhouse. And I think I'm a big believer in that.
What have you observed of this young Royals group? You saw them from the other side.
Yeah, extremely talented, young. I mean, there are some real similarities this year at certain points in the year. I mean, they were running out seven rookies in the lineup. We had a similar stretch in the middle of the year in Tampa this year as well, and that's extremely challenging to grow at this level, but the expected growth on the backside of that is a great thing to project, and so that's what I saw the most.
Andy Rogers.
Hey, Matt. Andy Rogers with MLB.com. Nice to meet you.
Thank you.
As a first-time manager, what advice have you gotten so far? I imagine this has been kind of a whirlwind of a week for you, but what kind of advice have you gotten?
Well, the most common thing you hear is just be yourself. You can't, through these processes, I've talked about being around Tito and Kevin Cash, and I can't be those guys. They're themselves, and they do great things because they're themselves. So that's the number one thing. And the other thing is, it's just something that I've seen, just collaborate. And any one person sits here and tells you that they have the answer, that's not the way. There's a collective group of minds here, and the players, we all have to rely on each other and take information back and forth.
And as far, you mentioned the family atmosphere and the young club, obviously. What did you learn about the organization through the interview process that made this organization the right fit for you?
Well, the things you just mentioned, it's extremely exciting to be with a young group of players that's just hungry to get better. I think the other main thing is that, I think there is a lot of infrastructure in place here to collaborate with, and that came shining through in the interviews.
Lynn.
JJ, first I wanted to ask, you mentioned Matt's personality, and I wondered what from the interview process came out that made you feel like it was a good fit with the group that you guys have?
With our players right now, I know they're eager to work with people that are willing to listen. And Matt kind of just exemplified how we saw how well he listens. We actually today met about 9 people in a department, and we quizzed him 2 seconds later, named 7 of the 9. You know, so he's very attentive, and I think that really matches well with our players and what they want out of a manager. And obviously, we got the pitching coach coming up. Same type of thing. So that's what stood out.
And then Matt Linworthy from the Kansas City Star. I wondered, just you mentioned a little bit of the infrastructure through the process. What I guess would be so your observations of the organization and how, if at all, has been different from maybe from afar looking at, you know, the Royals organization.
That's a really good question. You know, I don't think I would have been able to say what my perception was for the behind the scenes stuff from looking from afar. On the field, you see the talent, but you know, I. JJ and I have a little bit of a relationship going back to playing against each other in college a long time ago, and we had run into each other when we were both working in different capacities in the Dominican. So I've heard so many good things over the years about the way the people were treated here, and you know, had a little bit of a relationship with Dayton from playing against him as a college coach, and so that those things held true. But I didn't have any other notions about how things ran behind the scenes.
Sam McDowell,
Kansas City Star. Matt, you mentioned just the little bit of process for how you arrive at decisions. I wonder if you could shed a little bit of light on that.
Yeah, I mean, I think I've touched on it a few times, the collaboration. You know, I think we're going to spend a lot of time getting to know each other within the office, the field staff, the R&D department, all those things. And I think everyone gets a voice. Everyone has a, you know, the ton of information starts and it works its way to the field, and those processes to get that information and distill it down to the players is the process that we're going to work off of so that it can be clearly communicated to them.
John just mentioned the fact that you also interviewed the Royals. What are sort of the boxes you're looking for as you're going through that process?
Yeah, support. You know, I've mentioned this, I've said it straight to Mr. Sherman, like that in order to be process oriented, you have to have the support from ownership, and that spreads through the organization. You know, a very simple example is if somebody misses a ground ball in the 9th inning and we lose the game, if the owner's in the office and pounding the table after the game, then that attitude and that tension spreads to JJ and spreads to the office and then to the field staff, and everybody's coaching scared, playing scared, looking over your shoulder. And that was the furthest thing from what I got from the process. So that kind of stuff, the ability to collaborate, those things really stood out.
Todd
Bebo, Sports Radio 810. Kind of for both of you, I think John had mentioned earlier about data and analytics, and they had a lot of information here that maybe wasn't getting implemented. Maybe first from you, Matt, and then from you, JJ, kind of how you guys talked about those things and what sort of stuff maybe the Royals weren't doing that maybe you will do here with some of that information that the organization has had.
Well, I can't speak to what they weren't doing, and I wouldn't feel comfortable doing that anyway. Really, most teams have the same amount of data, and it's a matter of opening up the lines of communication between field staff, front office, R&D, strength and conditioning, everybody. And that's what I plan to do and what our staff will do.
And from our perspective, we just needed somebody that had a great acceptance of the information and an ability to utilize it and put it in play. It's one thing to have it and look at it, but now you need to know what to do with it. And when we spoke to Matt, it was pretty clear that has been part. He may not even realize it, but it's part of how he works every day, and it stood out.
And just follow up, Matt, like, this is kind of whatever new age data and things like that. You've been around the game for a long time. When did you become a true believer in some of the things that people are using now in baseball? Have you been a long time adopter of it?
Well, I mean, I was a minor league coach when Joe Maddon was managing and Andrew Friedman took over in Tampa. And so I was exposed to what then was new age, you know, shifting. And But just really more than anything, it's just being willing to accept a different way to look at things. You know, I think there's a tremendous amount of randomness in the game of baseball, right? And to think that you can control everything by a decision that I make or JJ makes, sometimes you just have to let go of the fact that you have the ultimate control over what happens. And that acceptance leads itself to the data. Like, in my mind, data doesn't make the decisions. It informs the decisions, and it creates more questions that you can ask that help you make better decisions down the road.
And also, just to add to that, too, I thought something that stood out to our committee, Matt had a great understanding where the game has been, where it is today, and where it's going, which is hard to predict. But somebody that has that growth mindset and intellectual curiosity, that's going to put us in a better position moving forward. So it really stood out to, across past, present, and future.
Dave Scrub.
Hey, Matt. Dave with the AP. You're coming from two organizations that are a little bit similar in that kind of small markets, kind of limited amount of resources, and yet they've consistently won. So what can you take as sort of commonalities from Cleveland and from Tampa that maybe you can plug here?
Pitching. You put good pitching on the field, you got a really good chance of winning. And I think one of the things that JJ's talked about a lot in the process is, but baseball, you know, the obvious narratives are the big spenders and the little spenders, right? But that doesn't really tell the whole story of what goes on the field. A lot of that goes into name recognition. But talent is talent, regardless of your experience level, your name recognition. So what I look at is winning those decisions on the margins. And, you know, the obvious ones everybody knows, you know, everybody wants to play the best players, everybody wants to get the best results. But where we're going to hopefully make strides is by winning those decisions that are 51-49 decisions and compiling those 51s up so you're consistently winning instead of consistently on the 49 side of it.
You sort of lead right into another obvious question around here. Pitching has been a struggle for this organization to develop for quite a while. So what do you envision for that going forward? And also, you're obviously going to have to build a staff, and pitching coaches can be part of that. So where do you see that going?
Yeah, well, there's a tremendous amount of talent on the pitching staff here right now. And I think I've talked to a handful of the guys already, and they are super anxious and eager to reach their potential. Now, I can't tell you exactly what the process has been, how their careers have gone up to this date, but what I'm looking for from now forward is maximizing their potential through some tweaks in approach or maybe pitch usage, those kinds of things, because the talent is clearly there, and I think we'll continue to add depth because, you know, you can start out the year with a 13-man staff, and you're going to end up using upwards of 25, 30 guys throughout the year. So it's a lot about depth. It's a lot about maximizing their abilities where they are right now. So that's, as far as a pitching coach, you know, a lot of the same characteristics and qualities that JJ talked about through this process will be apparent, because the way I feel about a staff is I'm not going to micromanage them. That guy will be the manager of the pitching staff along with the bullpen coach and the, you know, everyone that's involved in the pitching, the same with the hitting coaches. And they will be tremendous communicators, collaborators, forward thinking, curious, all those qualities.
Karen Kornacki, KNBC 9 News. Do you have someone in mind as a pitching coach?
You know, we've been talking a lot. We're compiling a list right now, much similarly to what JJ did for the manager search, based on those qualities, and we're gonna do our best to come up with the best candidate.
Being a longtime reporter here since 1983, watched a lot of old school baseball, love old school baseball. So I guess in this new age of everybody having an opinion, is it almost managing by committee and you just make the final job? How much is a manager's gut during a game? Like, okay, this guy's been out here, he just doesn't have it today, I should wait it through or I shouldn't. How much is gut with you since you have a vast background in baseball?
Are you available as a pitching coach?
I am, as a matter of fact, because I have lots of opinions. And I'm married to a former major league baseball player.
Okay. Well, the way I look at it is all that information, all the input are kind of the guardrails. And within those guardrails, there is room for interpretation. Now, the better we feel about our process and our information, the closer those guardrails get together, and we'll make those decisions within those parameters. But there's got to this game is played by human beings, and there's a lot of emotion. There's a lot of things that happen that no one ever knows about. Even the manager, the GM, guys come to the field every day with a whole set of things that have gone on in their lives, just like we all do. And to try to plug into where they are on a daily basis and help them compete to the best of their ability, that's what we're going to try to do, and that's where that human factor comes in.
Thank you.
Saran?
Matt, there's a kind of a difference that the fans would talk about, maybe not 13-17 when the Royals were at the top, but how transactional the Rays were, that there's a lot of movement. The Royals had great success. Mm-hmm. And are certainly known as one of the more loyal franchises, leading the way and paying their minor leaguers during the pandemic, all those things. And that's paid off in the past, but when things aren't going well, the town looks at Tampa and says, well, look at all the moves they make. We got to make more moves. Where's your philosophy on that? And what was the conversation like with JJ about, you know, these two kind of maybe philosophies trying to be blended together?
Well, I would first say that, you know, Tampa, they don't make moves just to make moves, right? They're all with a purpose behind them. And some of them are unavoidable due to injuries. Some of them are unavoidable because of pitchers get used during games and you need fresh arms for the next day. And that's kind of one of the things we did talk about, is building that depth. Because if you don't have that depth to draw from, then those moves are just moves to say we're doing something, and that's not what we're trying to do. So again, those moves are based on constantly trying to make those 51-49 decisions to incrementally make the team and the organization better.
There's a phrase in baseball, in fact, Jeff Montgomery over there is the one who taught it to me a long time ago, at some point you are what the back of your baseball card says you are, right? Like, you know, you can talk about getting guys better and all that, you know, when is that? When is a guy, what it, because you mentioned the talent that's here. There's some guys that have had some shots and haven't gotten over that hump. When are you just what the back of your baseball card says?
I would have Jeff answer that. I don't think I'm smart enough to know when each person is what they are on the back of their baseball card. But, I mean, you know, those are individual decisions on when guys have had enough chances or whatever, however you want to put it. But, you know, I'm coming in here. We're still learning the roster and each other and all those kinds of things. So I couldn't speak to this guy's had enough chances or that kind of stuff.
A few more before we do the
smaller groups. We'll go.
Andy, you have one more?
JJ, just to clarify, will you guys work in tandem to hire a pitching coach?
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Everybody that's worked with myself to hire Matt's going to join the group. So no question.
And then have you decided on any coaching staff?
Same as, I guess it was the day after the season. Our hitting staff will stay intact, and Damon Hollins will stay intact, and we're making decisions in with the other positions right now.
Lynn?
Matt, I think a lot of the discussion with this team for recent years, and also just this process, has been about the youth and then being process-oriented going forward. I wondered for you, with that context, what's going to be the measure or the bar for success early on with a young team where you guys are really getting into the process and sort of refining things with the organization?
You know, I think the best way I can answer that is the major leagues is the ultimate level of baseball, right? But it's not that development stops when you get to the big leagues. So these guys, the staff we have here and the staff we're going to put together is going to have a plan for each guy based on information we get from within the organization, from outside the organization, from the players themselves, on what we think they need to improve on. So once we're able to set up those individual development plans, or whatever you want to, however the best way to term it, we'll be able to follow a growth process in that. So I couldn't sit here today and say so-and-so's got to increase his on-base percentage or whatever. I think we need to dive into what those players need to work on and get their input as well.
Within that, I guess, the individual development is obviously going to be a primary focus, but I guess in the bigger picture for the team, how will you measure success? Why you're obviously, that's going to be a big part of the focus as well.
Yeah, I mean, when, you know, you can say all you want about processes and things, but at the end of the day, the big league is about winning baseball games. So we're hopefully going to win more games and fight our way to the top of the division. And how long that takes and, you know, what the bumps in the road look like on along the way, I can't sit here and tell you. You know, I would love to come out and say we're going to win 100 games, but that, you know, that's not something that anybody could sit here and tell you. But we're just going to try to compete on a daily basis and be in as many ball games as you can. And you know, I told JJ this morning, and anybody in baseball can sit here. You guys have watched a lot of baseball. The best teams to the worst teams in baseball, that line of winning night to night is razor thin. So doing those little things that swing the games, holding leads, coming back on somebody late and beating them when they have you down, those things, they need to happen in your favor and the good years, and that's what we have to try to focus on, is just swinging those razor thin differences.
Byrne, bring us home.
Matt, you talked about utilizing all 26 of your roster. When the players are being told by media and the outsiders about, you know, their numbers, when they're viewed as numbers, even by GMs around baseball, how do you make all 26 feel important when, you know, they might be the 26th man on that roster?
When they're being told their numbers?
Yeah, when they're viewed more as, you know, a batting average, an OPS, an ERA, when how do you make that connection, build that trust, and make all 26 feel important?
Well, a good way to start is not to view them as batting average and on-base percentage. So I think that's I'm the reason that you buckled me on that a little bit, because I don't think I've ever thought of a player that way. I think of them as a person first. And how do we do that is I've started calling guys, talking to them, seeing what they're thinking. And I couldn't be more transparent with that, in that I've told all of them, whatever you feel we need to do in this organization, on the field, off the field, you're not going to hurt my feelings. You need to let us know that, because this is their team. There's no manager of a major league team without those 26 guys. I could sit here and go out there and roll the balls out there myself with my kids, but there's, without those 26 guys and the 40 man and all the players, we don't have a job. So we're going to listen to them. And how do you make them feel important is by playing them and talking to them and using them. I mean, I was a bad player. I sat in that bullpen night after night after night, and that's no fun, right? Just catching bullpens or playing in the early morning games when the good players needed a break. These guys are major league players. They're the best of the best at what they do. And fostering that belief in themselves and what they can do to help. Everybody wants to be part of something bigger, right? We all want to have a purpose. And that's what these guys are going to do. Their purpose is to help win games and get us better.
Hi, guys.
Thanks for your time, JJ and Matt. You got the smaller groups, as you know.
But thanks for coming.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Nice job, guys. Wow. All right, we are back now, and we will be joined by the news
manager. Like, this is like church.
Before he comes over, Brett joins us right now. I'll cut you off if I need
to. Hey, have we met? Wait, like 32 years ago? I'm not exaggerating.
Sherman, how are you? Yes, we said, Bonnie's taking.